so astounding. Love is an ocean, you can drown it. The sweet embrace, the lovely taste, I taste the sea. I'm under grace, the place to be. It means I'll never need an umbrella. I'm cool in the cold, in the hot weather. Whether or never I ever understand, I'm a man in the hands of great plans. I stand with faith in a life I never know to touch. And still I stop and clutch, but I'm like, what's the dream of? What's the hope in? What's the life for? Live to no end, this is living. The life I've been given is a gift. If I'm a living, I'm a living to death. So what's the dream of? What's the hope in? What's the life for? And live to no end, this is living. The life I've been given is a gift. If I'm a living, I'm a living to death. Yeah.
Good morning, church. Ooh, whoa. Could we please dial that down? I've been told I like the sound of my own voice, but I don't like it quite that much. Good morning. It's good to be here this morning. A lot of people coming back, a lot of changes upcoming for especially our young folk. Summer's ending, which I like. I know a lot of people don't like summer ending. And we're finishing up our sermon series on God's top 10 today, which means next week we'll be starting a new one, but we'll come to that. But for now, let's just sit, enjoy the presence of each other, and enjoy the presence of God. Lord, as we come here right now, I pray that you would fill us with peace and calmness. I pray that your spirit would come down among us and fill us with thankfulness for today, and that we would worship with our full minds, full hearts, and everything we have. In your name, Lord. Amen.
Though the tears may fall, my song will rise, my song will rise. Though my heart may fail, my song will rise to you. While there's breath in my lungs, I will praise you, Lord. In the dead of night, I'll lift my eyes to you. When the waters rise, I'll lift my eyes to you. While there's hope in this heart, I will praise.
Mercy.
We read in Matthew chapter 6, verses 25 to 30. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith?
Broken for my regard.
Hello, my name is Joan. I have some announcements for you today, so let's get right to it, shall we? Our community garden is thriving, and now we have more vegetables than we know what to do with. Luckily for you, we have a stand right out front of the church with all sorts of fresh produce. Come out and take a look after the service. I assure you, you won't regret it. Next Sunday, we will once again be providing childcare for the nursery as well as starting a new sermon series. Just a reminder, our annual harvest food drive will take place on Sunday, September 29th. Pick up a flyer at the back of the sanctuary for more details. Our annual church get-together is coming up next week. Weekend 15 will commence on Friday, the 13th of September, and end on Sunday, the 15th. Don't miss out. It is a wonderful opportunity to grow in fellowship with each other and with God. And that's all. Oh, wait. Please don't forget. Stay out of my parking spot.
Thank you for doing that, Joan. That's awesome. A few more things that you ought to know. The weekend 15, less than 2 weeks away, there is a sign-up sheet being sent around right now. So if you'd like to fill out your information here, there is a cost. It's $15 per individual and $50 per family. All meals are included. It promises to be an awesome weekend. As you've just heard, we are starting a new sermon series next week on Genesis. You've just heard the dates, but we'll be returning to Genesis on May the 24th through to June the 28th later this year. Also in our sermon series this year, Ask Dr. Luke. That's starting on December the 1st, going all the way through to April 19th. And another split series, Living the Abundant Life, which starts April 26th, probably just after the Genesis series, and that's going all the way through to May 1st, and then again July 5th to the 26th. And for our summer, we will be going through the Psalms for Every Occasion, August 8th to September 9th. There will be another Dyson screening for volunteers during the weekend. It is set for the Saturday afternoon, Saturday the 14th in the afternoon. And the Festival of Creation is this month, September 28th, on the Saturday from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. We've invited a whole bunch of artists to come in and create art on that day. So if you'd like to join us for that, please feel welcome. We are going to be sending our kids out to Kitopia Light in a moment. If you would like to use the nursery, it is available for use, but it is not staffed. So if you are going up to the nursery, we would ask that you remain with your children there. Margaret, if I could ask you to pray for our kids.
All right, let's pray, guys. Heavenly Father, we thank you once again for this day. We thank you that you've brought kids into this church. We pray that your Holy Spirit would be with us as we spend time with one another and reflect on your goodness to us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Blessed be your name in the land. Walk
Blessed be the name above every other name, and the name that saves us from our sins. As we enter this time of confession and repentance, I invite you to take a solemn moment and reflect back on your week, month, however far back you feel necessary to, and look back and look at the things that that we've done wrong and the things we failed to do correctly. So we know the gospel has some bad news for us, but also some great news. And the bad news comes in Romans 3, 23 and 24. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But the great news, and all are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. We've all messed up, and we all know that the wages, the cost of that mess up is death, eternal separation from God. But there's this great hope that if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. It takes a confession. It takes us knowing that we're wrong and coming to God and saying, I'm sorry. Please forgive me. Please help me not to wrong you again. So in silence, ask God the Father to help you acknowledge and confess your sins when they happen. Then ask the Holy Spirit to point out to you any unconfessed sin in your life. Confess it, admit it, and turn from it in his power, and be confident that the death of Jesus has redeemed you. If you'd like, you can pray this prayer with me. Father, I choose to place my faith in the completed work of Jesus Christ, your Son, alone, and not in my own efforts or in my own goodness, nor do I presume upon your grace. I have sinned, I admit it, and I am deeply sorry. I ask for your forgiveness because I believe that Jesus has already fully paid the punishment on the cross for all the sins that I have committed and all the times when I did not faithfully and wholeheartedly trust and obey you. I receive your forgiveness with joy and deep gratitude. Please send the Holy Spirit into my life to help me repent and change my thinking, values, and behavior so that I may live a full and fruitful life as your child, loving and pleasing you first and foremost. I ask this in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen. And we have this great promise from Isaiah. I, even I, am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake and remembers your sins no more. It is gone. It is forgotten. It is not remembered by God. And now that we've made peace with God, I'd ask that we offer the peace to each other. So the peace of God be with you. And of course, the brilliant thing about all of this is that we have time after the service as well. It's a bit hard to rein them in as they get going. And the Lord be with you all. If you could just, if you could take your seats for a moment. To move into a time of praise and prayer. Just a moment ago, I asked that you take a look back on your week and think of all the times that we've messed up and we've confessed that. But could we also take a moment to look back on our week and see where the places that God has really been present and been evident in our lives? What are we thankful for, and what can we praise God for? Have a mic up here if anyone would like to share, and be more than happy to give it up.
I'd like to sum up the summer a little bit with thanks. We've had four different speakers. We've had four different leaders. We've had four different worship leaders. We've had three great students this summer. Sydney, who's responsible for that video today with Joan. Well done. That was really well done. I will never park there again. And Branwyn and Shamar, we've been blessed with an inordinate amount of people to fill in over the summertime. So I'd like to thank you all. I'd like to thank God for providing those opportunities. And we've learned a lot. Hey, Tammy, it's been a really good summer. So thank you all, and thank you, Tammy, for the last month. I shouldn't say the whole summer. We've all been here the whole summer, but for the last month especially. Amen.
So what I want to thank God for is there are several of us here who had to leave their children at a faraway institution. And I'm just thankful that our children have grown in the Lord in this church, and that they're seeking to follow the Lord even far away. And I want to thank the Lord for that, for my own child, Matthew, but also for all of our children who seek to follow the Lord, and that we as a church would continue to raise our children so that they would seek to follow the Lord when they're away. So thank you, Lord.
Good morning, everybody. I just want to praise God because the cancer was removed successfully from Adam's mom's breast. And thank you for your prayers. Thank you.
Is there anyone else? All right, well, I don't want to pull out anyone who doesn't want to be out, but we are indeed thankful for all of that. And similarly, is there anything anyone would like prayer for?
Some of you may have noticed that our incredible keyboardist is not here today. He was scheduled to be here, Jerry Karingi. He is just not well this morning. So we want to ask a special prayer for Jerry. You may have noticed last week when he was here, he was having a very difficult time climbing the stairs. So just a special prayer and thoughts for Jerry Karingi, our wonderful, talented keyboardist who gives so much of his time and talent to the betterment of this whole community.
Should I stand up? I just wanted to say thank you for the beautiful worship here. And I go to a church, an Emmanuel Church in Richvale, But just this week, we're having a lot of family problems. And my grandson, who's 17, had to be taken by ambulance because he was he had an anxiety attack. So I just ask you to pray for our family. And his name is Logan. Pray for him. They're just going back to school now, and things are probably going to be difficult for him. So thank you.
If we could just pray for these. Lord, we're so thankful for everything you've done for us today and throughout our lives. I thank you so much for the help you have provided in the month where many of us were away, many of our leaders were on vacation. Thank you so much for equipping and enabling those that stepped up to step up and serve you. Thank you for our young people who have grown up in this church. I thank you for your guidance on their lives thus far. And I pray as they head off that they would find good, godly communities to land themselves into, and that your guidance would still be with them even though they are away from us. I pray for those of us who are having health struggles, Jerry and Logan. God, you are the great healer and you are the great peace. And I pray that you would heal those who are struggling, both physically and mentally, and that they would take this time and come to experience you deeper and closer. In your name, Lord. Amen. I'd like to, at this point, invite up Ryan, the last of our guest speakers, so I don't suppose you could call him a guest. I was saying to him this morning, it's interesting because I've never gotten to introduce him for anything, so I'm really happy for this. Can we just pray for you? Lord, I thank you so much for Ryan. I thank you for his mentorship on my life and on the lives of those he teaches. I pray right now that the words that he says would be inspired by you, and that the messages that you've given him would be communicated clearly, and that it would stick to us beyond the end of the service, but also for the week and for the rest of our lives. In your name, Lord. Amen.
Morning. So this morning, we're going to be looking at the last of God's top 10, the last of the 10 commandments. So if you have your Bibles with you, please turn to Deuteronomy chapter 5. I'm afraid I finally give in and admit that I can't see as well as I used to. I looked down this morning at my iPad, which has a fairly sizable font on it, and I'm looking at it, starting to trombone, and I think, eh, whatever. So, Deuteronomy 5:21. So, the commandment is here, which, where'd it go? There it is! You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, and you shall your neighbor's house, his field, his female servant, his donkey, or anything that is your neighbor's. Is this better? Awesome. And so we begin with this this first commandment that is about how we treat one another. There, by the way, are a couple of typos in your notes. Sorry. And probably in the presentation. And when we look at this is the final of the commandments. This is number 10. This is the ending of God's top 10. And when we look at this, this, like the other six commandments that come at the end of the 10, are about how we deal with one another. And I think that one of the things that's really important for us is to recognize that this is really about love. This is really what it comes down to. Jesus said, in Matthew 22, he said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. And so when Jesus sums up the law, the Mosaic law, the 613 commandments of which these are the first 10. What he says is it's about love. It's about how you love God, and it's about how you love one another. And this is the key in all of this. In the commandments that speak about how we deal with God, having no other gods, taking time apart for God, when we take time to rest and to focus on Him, this is about loving God, honoring our parents, not killing people, not committing adultery, not bearing false witness, not coveting. These things are about how we show love to others. Jesus in John 13 commanded us to love, and he also went on and said that as Christians, this is how other people know that we are his followers, because it's the love of Christ that will draw people to him. And so when we show them love, they want to know what it is that drives us to love this way, and we can share Jesus with them because people need Christ. We all have the problem of sin. The other function of the law is to show us that we need Christ. That's what the New Testament tells us. And so when we show love and when we follow that law, of course, we can't do it on our own, and we need the Lord Jesus Christ. And so God, in his love, sent him. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." See, there's the key. If you haven't put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, right now you do not have a right relationship with God. Right now you face the penalty of your sin. But Jesus took that. And by putting your trust in him, you can have everlasting life. You can look forward to eternity in heaven with him, to understand what it is to be in a loving relationship with God, and then, as these commandments show us, to show love to one another. And so when we look at this, one of the key things to remember then is that we're not satisfied with what we have, right? That's the title that for this message is, be satisfied with what you have. When we are not satisfied with what we have, we do not focus on God, which is where our focus is supposed to be. And so let's look at the commandment. I mean, most of us, I don't think, generally run around using the word covet all the time. I'd say hands up, but I'm pretty sure none would go up, except for maybe Peter. So when we look at this word, it's a word we're not used to, and we have to understand something about it. It is not just the idea of wanting something similar to what others have. So, you know, it's not like you look at your neighbor's house and, wow, that's a really nice house. I would love to have a house like that. Your neighbor's house is to look at that house and say, I want his house, that specific house. So when we look at this word covet, what it says to us is that we are actually desiring and wanting to take away what someone else has. And if you look at the words in the commandment, it picks things that are fairly specific that, you know, it's not necessarily, you know, just wanting something similar. To covet your neighbor's wife, to want somebody else's spouse, or their home, or the, you know, their servants, or any of these things. This is the issue that we get, that people, that if we are coveting, we want to take that. And that can lead to some horrible, horrible things. We look at the story of David, and of course David was the great king, the poet, the shepherd, the one who slew Goliath, and yet at the same time, when he was on that rooftop, he saw Bathsheba, and the wife of Uriah, not the wife is Uriah, sorry. He sees Bathsheba, he desires her, and then he has Uriah murdered so that he can have her. He coveted someone else's wife. And is an attitude. It is a desire that intends harm to others. to want a, you know, a decent home, or, you know, a spouse that is, you know, a wonderful person, that's great. I mean, there's no problem with that. To want a particular person's spouse or home is the sin. It's not love, it's malice, it's envy. And we have to be aware of that. And so how do we deal with this? Well, the first thing is that we must watch and we must guard our thoughts and our desires. We have to be careful and realize when those thoughts come to us. Because rather than wanting what other people have, we really should be thankful for what God has given us, what God has blessed us with. In fact, we should be thankful that God has blessed others in the way that he has as well. We should be thankful for God's blessing of others rather than desiring that for ourselves. But of course, when these thoughts come up, the question is, how can we deal with them? What can we do? And one of the things that I think helps is to make sure that we focus on what is good. This is a great verse in Philippians 4 and verse 8. Finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue, and if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. And this word meditate, I think, speaks to us of an intention. We don't just let those thoughts flit across our mind, but rather we choose to focus on those rather than other thoughts. Be it thoughts of coveting or of doubt or sadness or doubting your faith or worrying, all of these things, when we focus on what is good, when we focus on the things that are of God, we can find peace, but we must meditate on them. When you find yourself with thoughts that you don't want, intentionally focus on what we know is true, what we know is good. What we don't want is to have our focus taken off God and onto other people's stuff or any other thing, because that's really what happens. And so we must refocus our thoughts and pray, of course. Our first recourse should be prayer, to pray to the Spirit that he will focus our thoughts where they should be, that he will cleanse us of these wrong thoughts and desires. Because the other thing we face is that this also means that we are lacking in contentment and gratitude. I mean, if we want what other people have, we're not content with what we have, and we're not thankful for what we have. There's no gratitude there. In 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 6 to 7, this is what Paul says. He says, "Now godliness with contentment is great gain, for we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out." Okay? I mean, you know, you've all heard, you can't take it with you when you go. And that's completely true. Because we came into this world with nothing, we're going to leave with exactly the same thing. And so when we are focusing on what others have, we have no contentment. And I think that one of the connections that Paul makes here is really important, because he says it is godliness with contentment. And I think a lack of contentment and a lack of gratitude pulls us away from God, because we have the wrong perspective. And we focus on the wrong things. And we aren't close to God. Remember, Jesus said that we are to focus on God and the things of God in that passage we looked at in Matthew 22. And also to realize that God provides, as in the verses that Josh read to us earlier. I was really happy to see those verses. I hadn't actually included them in my sermon, but I'd been thinking about them the whole time I was preparing. So it was nice to have them there. And now I can blame him for having that extra stuff. But if we want to fully live our lives in service to God, we need this perspective check. What are we focusing on? Where our treasures is, that's where our heart will be. That's also what our Lord says in the Sermon on the Mount. Where's our heart? Where are our treasures? See, we're not focused on God if we're seeking the things of this world. I'm sorry, it's kind of a downer. We're going to get to some fun stuff, I promise. But we can't serve God and our desire for things, especially what belongs to other people. Jesus did say in Matthew 6:24, so I did get to the chapter, "No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other." You cannot serve God and mammon. When I was a kid, I had no idea what this word meant. I think I had some sort of weird thought in my mind. It was a kind of meat. I was a weird kid. But it just means riches or money, okay? If we are pursuing the things of this world, we are going against the things of God. You see, this is really an issue that we have to address. When we put our focus on the things of this world, it says that we despise the other master. Actions speak louder than words. And therefore, if what we do is pursue these things and desire these things, then it seems like we do not want, desire, or even give value to the things of God. We can't have it both ways. How this works for us. And of course, to covet somebody else's possessions, somebody else's things, that's actually even worse, because we're not only not loving by absence, we're actually going against the idea of loving one another, and we are desiring their things. I mean, Paul is a great example of this. There's the great passage in Philippians 4 where he talks about how he's happy that the Philippians have been sending him support again. But he says this, and this is a wonderful statement, because Paul knew what it was to suffer for the sake of Christ. And in the context of this, he speaks of this contentment in his own ministry. And he says this, Philippians 4:11, "For I have learned in whatever state I am to be content." I have learned in whatever state I am to be content. This is a guy who was stoned. This is a guy who was shipwrecked numerous times, whipped, beaten, you name it. It pretty much happened to him. And this is a guy who says, "I am content in all these things." Notice that he is content in all these things, and in his ministry, he did great things for God. It's a little bit different. He says, "I am content in all things." The Rolling Stones tell us, "I can't get no satisfaction." And our society tells us exactly the same thing. It's hard to be content in this world that we live in, because we are bombarded constantly by things that tell us, "Oh, you shouldn't be happy. Your car isn't good enough. Your house isn't good enough. You're wearing the wrong shoes. You're drinking the wrong pop. You need to have this, to have that." I think it was Rockefeller who, when somebody asked him, Rockefeller, one of the richest men in America back in the early 20th century, and they asked him, "Okay, so how much money is enough?" And this is the answer that tells you exactly where priorities lie. He said, "Just a little bit more. Just a little bit more." There's no contentment there. There's no peace there. And God is a God of peace. There's no real love there if you're focusing on the things that you desire for yourself, especially if they are at the expense of others. And sadly, so much of what we see as gain comes at the expense of others, be it directly or indirectly based on how others have to suffer for these things. But how do we do this? I mean, that's really the hardest question. With an attitude. And it's one thing to say, "Okay, I know how not to kill people. I'm not going to kill people. I'm not going to steal stuff. But at the same time, how do we deal with an attitude that is so focused on the things of this world that we are willing to want, that we want to take them from other people for us? How do we deal with that? And I think what we need to do is cultivate our gratitude to God. If desiring what others have is the very opposite of contentment, then pursuing gratitude to God becomes what we must do. In order to, if we are always thankful to God for the blessings he's given us, we're not going to be looking at other people and saying, I want that guy's stuff. Because what we're doing is praising God for how he's blessed us. Again, this is key. How do we do this? How do we ensure that we are thankful? Because that's important. This is cultivating an attitude of thankfulness, not just saying the words. And I mean, the first thing is that we should focus on thanks in our prayers. I mean, Paul says, praying in all things with thanksgiving. With thanksgiving. We show thankfulness to God for all of the things that he's blessed us with. Of course, if you've put your faith in Christ, first and foremost, it is our salvation. There are so many big things. But I also think that it's important to focus on all of the things. Because often when we get caught by these attitudes, we're not necessarily desiring wrongly the huge things. Perhaps it's smaller things. And if we are looking at the world in a way that we seek things to be thankful for, the beauty of it is to find the small things in life that we are thankful for. Those little things that happen to us every day that we often miss. A friend of mine suggested keeping a list of the little things that we're thankful for. The little things. At last check, I think he's running somewhere around 10,000. Somewhere around 10,000 or so. And nothing is huge. And he thinks of them in the moment. And I mean, these are little things. You know, we pay attention to them. You know, the sound of a bird singing in the morning. Fresh air after a rain. The first sip of really good coffee. And I'm not kidding, actually. That's one of the things I try to remember to do. Is to take a moment and just shut everything else out and just enjoy it for what it is and be thankful. If you hate coffee, try tea. If you don't like tea, I don't know. I'm lost because, I mean, tea. Good clean water. I don't care. Whatever. Whatever little things there are, you know, taking a moment, seeing the sun break through the clouds, a flower growing in the middle of a parking lot, a bunny in the backyard, you know, whatever it happens to be. You know, these things, these small things, because God blesses us in so many ways, and it's important for us to see those. But what that really means is that we have to look for God's blessings in the moment. And this is also something that is difficult for us to do. Our society is so focused on distracting us and pulling us away from everything around us. I'm not saying there aren't things that you can be thankful for when you're playing Angry Birds, but you may not notice the other things. And I like Angry Birds, for the record. But that's the thing. And it's, again, something that is intentional. I struggle with this, trying to be present and to be in the moment and to focus on what God is doing even in that moment. A classroom can be a really frenetic environment, especially in high school. And sometimes it's easy to get pulled in all those directions. And sometimes it's just taking a moment, taking a breath, and in that breath remembering to thank God for what he's done and to refocus on him. And it's a practice. It's something that we have to do with discipline and with intent. Not easy. It's not easy. There's so much there. I mean, I got the attention span of a gnat. And so I have the hardest time focusing on anything. Ask my wife. Okay? I'm just saying, okay? And it's important then to take that time, though, and focus on these things, because it's only when we are present that we experience the presence of God, which is something I think we can be truly thankful for. And I'll say that again, because I love just the way, I just love that idea. It's only when we are present that we experience the presence of God. And it is that presence of God that draws us to him. It's that presence of God that shows us what love is. As we come to the end of this series, and of course of this particular message, it is a sin to covet, because what it does is it causes us not to love others, and we are commanded to love. And of course, when we're focusing on what others have, we're not focusing on God. And when we are not focusing on God, we are not near him. We are not able to rejoice for others. We are not able to rejoice in the things that God has given us. You see, the point of the law for us, as we look at it, as we look at what Christ has said, because he boiled it all down, essentially what it is to teach us about a life of love. And that's so important. To live a life that in action shows that we love God. To live a life that in our actions show that we love one another. That we love those who are not in God's family yet. To reach out to them. To show them what God's love is. If we are selfish, we cannot show the selfless love of God. And we are to live a life of love. And I will say this, because I believe it is 100% true. Only when we live and serve as God wants us to, only then can we have the true joy and satisfaction in life that he desires for us. If we are willing to believe that God's word is true, and God's word tells us that through fellowship with God, as John says in 1 John chapter 1, that then our joy can be full, then when we are going against who God is, there's no joy in our lives. There's nothing in our lives that will bring us happiness. When we want what other people have, when we lack satisfaction, what we have in what God has given us, what happens is that our joy is stripped away. We take no joy in who God is and the relationship that we have with him. That's the importance here. If you're going to look at what these commandments are here for, it is twofold. The first is most important. It shows us our need for Christ. If you have not put your faith in Christ today, look at who he is and what he has done and the love that he has shown for us, and realize that you need a Savior and you have to trust in him. And for those of us who are saved, first and foremost, we can rejoice and be thankful for that. But the other thing that the principle of these commandments shows us is that God has called us to a life of love. Jesus said, "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. As I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this, all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." It brings our focus around to that which is most important, And that is a focus always on God, to always look to Jesus, the author and finisher of faith, to see him as our goal, to see him as our example, to see him as our prize. That is what we truly seek. Let's pray. Our Father and our God, thank you so much that you have loved, you gave us your Son, and that you have called us to a life of love, that they may see and desire your Father. We ask that you would bless us and draw nearer to you, love you and each other more and better than we have. And we pray this in the one who gave his life, in the name of the one who gave his life out of love for us, and who looked forward only to the joy that was set before him, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Sorry. Thank you for that, Ryan. Thank you for the reminder that we are called to be thankful for what we have and called to love one another. During this next song, we are going to be taking our collection. If you are a guest with us today, please be our guest. There is no obligation or pressure to give.
You were the Word at the beginning.
Thank you.
The Lord speaks to us, reveals new meaning to us, brings new light and meaning to things we'd long known. Just during that past song, I felt the Lord reminding me of an old song that takes on new meaning in light of what Brian's just said. The chorus goes, "Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full into his wonderful face, and all the things of this world will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace." So Lord, I pray right now as we go from here that you would help us to be thankful, that we would look around and see all the great works you've done. And I pray that you would, in the light of all of that, you would help us to love our neighbors, love them as much as ourselves. In your name, amen. Hey, if you want prayer, Duck is up here with a team. Everything you say to them will be kept completely confidential. But beyond that, go in peace.
You have no